maintenance for your heart. It needs to be open and sharing and extending every day. And today we started off with our expression sessions this morning, and I feel they're very important. They're a very important part of every retreat that we do, and they're a very important part of our daily living, this expression sessions. I feel like in societies and cultures where there's a lot of blocks to expressing emotions, talking things through, opening up, if there's a lot of repression and suppression, then there also will be a lot of anger and guilt and even rage that's built up, that's like pushed down if there isn't a means for expression. And it varies in different cultures as I travel around the world, but those cultures where there's open touch, where there's lots of expressing the emotions, I feel are the ones that have the greatest inroads to awakening and to health and to true inner peace. And in this world, there are mechanisms like going to see counselors and psychotherapists periodically, but even some of those approaches can be quite limiting if there's a lot of advice giving, if you go to support groups where there's a lot of crosstalk, where you've got things that you really feel you're there to share and you're there to be supported in, and then when people start to crosstalk or try to fix, you know, it's like an egoic fixing mechanism where you try to jump in when they hear a few lines and go, well, here, let me tell you, this is what you should do, get your life in order, and you hardly get to say anything, and then the big fixing, the voice of the fixer comes in. And I think with families, we've been aware of this through family patterns, sometimes through churches, sometimes through psychotherapists and counselors. We encounter these things. So in order to have this deep, authentic healing, you have to have a sense of safety and security in letting up the emotions. And I think even originally in Catholicism, when they had a priest, someone you would confess your sins to, that was the original intention, was to have a non-judgmental, loving presence of wisdom and maturity that could be there just to allow these emotions up and these hidden thoughts up. Because if we don't allow them up, then they get turned inward and stuffed down, and it's not pretty. That's where we have dis-ease that I think begins to develop. It's a dis-ease in the mind, and there's no outlet for expression, so it gets projected onto the body, such as cancer and other types of diseases. So we have a regular practice of expression sessions. In fact, for years now, when we have had lunches, we use the lunches for expression sessions. So people will get their food and they'll bring it in to a table, usually it's a large table or a big round table, and then there's a spaciousness there for, as people are eating, for whoever has something bubbling to the surface that really needs to talk about it. But the purpose of these expression sessions is more of the attitude of complete non-judgment. It's for everyone to practice being present and letting these thoughts come up and holding, you might say, holding the light or holding the highness, which is what you need to allow these emotions to come and pass through. And so it takes a while. Sometimes it takes a while to develop that because it takes a trust and a safety that has to grow stronger and stronger. Helen was mentioning a retreat that we did in Noosa, Australia, and it was a large group like this, and over the first maybe 3 days of the retreat, everybody started to develop more trust and feel more open-hearted, and then a man came in the middle of the week, maybe like Wednesday, and he said, I hope I could join right in, and I love these expression sessions, and everyone cheered him on, saying, go ahead, come on, come in, come and heal with us, we're in the presence of healing. And then he got up and he expressed all his pedophile thoughts, and the people were just like, and a lot of women, I suddenly had a stream of women at my door for one-on-one counseling sessions. Really excited. Come on. Oh God. They were pretty extreme. And he came right out with them and he dressed them in the whole large group and the whole place just shook a bit. But overall, by the end of the week, you know, people could feel that was helpful too. That made them look at their thoughts and their judgments of him. And all kinds of things, and it was like the Spirit was with us. The Spirit is with us with everything. And that's what I said in the beginning, we have to get to a point where there's nothing taboo, there's nothing hidden, there's nothing off limits. The power, the strength of God, the glory of God can handle anything that the ego can throw up into awareness, and that's why we have suppression and denial, is because the thoughts are already judged as negative, and then they're pushed out of awareness. And we have to be willing to let them come into awareness. If we aren't letting them come into awareness, then it's not going to work. One time we were at our monastery, and we had a husband and wife that were there from Australia. And you know these browsers that you can turn on something on the browser where it's like a history of memory. And also, when you start typing, if you type something from history, it will, to save time, it will come up. Well, apparently, one day, I guess they were using the laptop they brought from Australia, and the wife was using it, and the husband had been on, probably systematically for a long period of time, on a number of porn sites. And they were all in the history of the browser, and more than that, she had typed something into the browser and misspelled it, and before she knew it, and so she just started screaming at the top of her lungs at our monastery out there in the canyon. The rocks are good for that. The rocks. Scream all you want at the rocks. They don't mind. It's been here for probably millions of years. So she was screaming, and I was in the office, and I looked at my friend Lisa, and Lisa looked at me, and she went, "Who died? Who got shot?" Someone surely had been shot, because then they came in, and she was screaming at the top of her lungs, and he had this real sheepish look on his face. He was all bright red. And so we talked for about a half an hour, and then it was like we came to a lunchtime expression session, so I thought, I think I'll sit in on the expression session today. And it actually triggered for some of the other men that were there. They felt, and that was their cue to bring up their thoughts about pornography and addictions. And there was a big, you could feel a huge swirling healing energy going on. Like, okay, that was pornography day at the monastery. We waited years before it finally came around, but it finally did come to pornography day, and that's good. You should have a pornography day. It's going to heal the whole universe. You know, we have to have these days where we allow things. Okay, today it's going to move through. Okay, this is good. And everybody felt better. You could feel the energy at the end of the lunch. It was like a long session. It went on longer than usual for a couple hours. But there was a lot of healing that went on. And so, in working with the Course in Miracles, it's designed as a self-study course, a self-study curriculum, but that's just kind of, a lot of people do study it in groups because it's so deep, and it's a bit threatening, obviously, to the ego, because it's like, whoa, what is this? This is stirring the pot, stirring the spoon big time. And then what you do with it is you really have to have a big allowance to let the Spirit orchestrate your life, orchestrate the course groups. And that's what I've noticed over these past 30 years with the course. It's been a time of prayer and a time of asking the Holy Spirit and Jesus, what is it that would be most conducive, what would be most helpful? And even doing a lot of retreats like this over the years, there's certain things that come in, little things, no, that worked very well, that's very helpful, we'll remember that. These little things that you remember, because you want it to be the most beneficial, the most impactful, and you want, above all else, for there to be a feeling of trust and safety. That healing can only occur in the presence of trust and safety. There was one time when I was, I think, in the Blue Mountains of Australia, and I did like a week-long retreat up in the Blue Mountains, and then at the end, I set out, opened it up for one-on-ones, and we put out a sign-up sheet, and I think there was like 35 or 38 people signed up, so I had to do like 7-minute one-on-ones. Okay, next. But I also said, let's make the best of these 7 minutes. And so people would come in and they would unburden themselves. They would use those 7 minutes to get in touch with and express to me their deepest, darkest secrets. Sometimes saying things like, I've never told another living human being this, not even my parents. Then boom. And it felt good. There was a healing energy behind it. And what was that all about? Was simply they knew that they could speak anything to me. Absolutely anything. It could be absolutely anything. They could speak it, and I would smile at them, I would hug them, we would feel the grace of God, the presence of love right there, and the loosening would occur immediately. Because that's what we need in healing. We need to at least tune in enough to the Spirit to have, you know how it is, if you have a really good friend who you can talk, tell anything to, and you can laugh with, how healing that is, how light, how loving, we need to cultivate that. And that's what I have really been cultivating in my life, and those who come to work with me or live with me, we're really into going into the place of non-judgment. Now that is a very deep state of mind, a state of pristine non-judgment. For most, it takes a lifelong of work to come into that presence, where there's absolutely no judgment, positively or negatively, on anything. And so, to come into that, we've come together, we've worked together, we've collaborated together, we've lived together, and we do learn how to pray, and we do learn how to hear the Holy Spirit, because if you get a group of people of any size, unless you learn to pray together and tune in to the Holy Spirit, you're going to have all kinds of arguments and conflicts, and we all know that. That's the human condition. We've been through that with our families. We've been through that with our relationships. You know, it can be nice for a while, but then just a lot of darkness can come in, kind of blindside you. It's almost like it can just seem to sabotage and take over things. And for all of us, it's been shocking. Every time the ego rears its head, every time we have this inner psychic beast that comes out, it's just shocking. It's not natural to us. We were created as love. We feel very natural when we're flowing in love and we're connecting. Even when the I Love You of the song, when everyone started singing, and then you could just feel the natural waves of love just flowing through. It's almost like a current that flows. It's so natural. That's how we were created. We were created by God as love. And anything other than that love, it's shocking to our system. And so we gain trust and we gain permission to start to ease back into that love, that feeling of safety. That feeling of our first thoughts when we wake up in the morning, of easing into the day very softly, very gently, and having loving thoughts coming in to greet the new day. You know, that's very natural. That's a natural way for us to enter into every So I feel like that's a big part. What we did this morning is a big part of our retreat, and I did hear some expressions that some people had some things to express and they didn't really feel they had an opportunity. And even though we're going to use our afternoons generally for free time and time to integrate, I think that also would be another good use of the afternoon, is perhaps to have an afternoon session, if it's felt, where people who feel like they had more to share, or that they didn't get the opportunity to fully share and express in the morning sessions, have an opportunity to do that. Because everyone should feel how powerful that is. Everyone should feel that opportunity. And then for those of you even that felt you did have an opportunity to share and express, if you want to come and practice holding the presence, being the loving presence there, that can be spoken into, that would be wonderful too. That's a wonderful experience. Sometimes I've done retreats where we've done what's called diet work, where we break people into twos and people sit across from someone, and basically one person will start off with expressing in an uncensored way. They'll just, almost like Freudian free association, but in an uncensored way, they'll just let their thoughts and emotions come up and vocalize them. And then the other person is playing the role of the spirit, the presence of unconditional love. And occasionally they may have a line or a workbook lesson from the Course periodically just softly come up as a soft reminder of love and presence. And then after a period of maybe 20 or 30 minutes, they'll switch off, and then the one who's playing the presence of love will get to express. And the other. I've even had people who have sprung into mystical experiences from just a very simple exercise like this, because they've never allowed themselves the opportunity to do that their entire life. And then when they do, they're quite amazed at that. That's the power of coming together with the intention to heal. Because most human interactions, we just didn't really realize that that was an option. Nobody told us we could do that. Nobody told us we could use relationships in that way. And it could be very healing, even in couples, to have a presence of love session, you could call it, where you bring things up. I think a lot of times with relationships too, remember, the ego set this world up, so when you seem to get into relationships, there's a lot of expectations that come in, and a lot of roles, like heavy-duty roles that come in, almost like overlays that come in, and that can really stifle the healing and stifle the unfoldment of love when these preconditioned, these past conditioned roles come in and you simply just lock yourself in, like fall back into an old default of how you saw your parents or how you saw the people around you. It's almost like that's an old condition, and you slide from this high space down, you slide down to this old groove, just a deeply worn groove in the mind, and then you just can go for years in a groove until you see there's something more. And then you begin to train your mind to come out of the groove, go higher and higher. That's very important. It's so easy to get locked in the familiar, where it's a pretty intense world and there's a lot of intense emotions in the mind, so the mind just kind of locks in and latches on to something familiar because it just doesn't know any better. And it's just going to go back to what it knows. And so what we want to encourage is expansiveness, where you start to see a whole new way of relating. Typically when you talk to people about relationships, there's typical channels and boxes and concepts that you kind of tick off and you love to talk about them. But I think from the movie last night, we got the sense that there is another way of relating. By the time she came back around in the very end, she basically was willing to get married more from a purpose standpoint, not from a form standpoint, because she wasn't marrying into any kind of form. She was marrying into a connection that she felt. And she had plenty of opportunity to really find that connection. And when she did, it's like this current of this energy, she was willing to stay married. Then she said, when she saw the ring, he had prepared the ring long ago, so it was in his mind. And then she said, "Now you know, you have to propose to me." And it was really beautiful. That's kind of the way my life has gone, in the sense that when you get into the purpose, when you give your life over to Spirit, then the Spirit will send to you the people, the situations, everything that you need in kind of a holographic sense to help you go all the way into awakening. So it's very much taking you off the timeline of this begins, this ends, you know, all the things that we talk about typically in terms of relationship. When did it begin? How long did it last? What was the quality of it? You know, what was the good points? What was the bad points? This is like almost like a scorecard of how did this little linear relationship go? Here's your scorecard. To let the Holy Spirit bring people and relationships in your life in order to serve the whole. For example, I was a shy guy. I was a very shy guy, so I didn't even like to travel, but my part in the plan was to travel and do these kind of intimate sharings and gatherings in many countries, many cultures. And I had no inclination, David had no inclination for it, but it was more like I had willingness, especially after the Course came into my life, and I could see, wow, there's a much bigger picture here, and there's much more going on than meets the eye, so I'm willing. And then I would have people that would travel with me, and then when I started going to countries where I didn't speak the language, then there was this, Jesus kept sending me translators, which made the experience much more helpful for everyone, for me to have these gifted translators that were very much linked with me in purpose. Then we could get on a stage, even if we'd never met, there was some kind of a synergy to get on the stage together, and away we would go, sometimes for hours or days, just being used together, even though we'd never met. We were brought together and used in that way. I think of with Marion too. Marion was, I found you through YouTube, and then we did a little chat through there, and then that's how you came here. And I could probably write an entire book on, over the last 25 years, all the singer-songwriters that have been brought into my life, that have blessed all these gatherings and travels that I've done. And it becomes a different style of country and folk music and opera singer and folk. You know, it's a whole range, male and female, of ones. I remember going to Stockholm over here in Europe, and then there was this woman that showed up one time. I kept being taken to the same yoga center every time I would go to Stockholm. And she showed up, and she was just so deep into non-duality presence, and she said, "Could I sing a few songs at the beginning of your gathering?" I just met her at the event. I said, "Sure." She got up on stage, and I mean, she sang three songs, and the whole place just dropped into a deep stillness. Mm-hmm. Now that's orchestrated. You meet somebody for the first time, and then they show up, and she's got such a devotional life, and the whole place, you know, that just launched us into a very deep, almost like a satsang experience there. And I've had some that have been able to travel with me. They've been able to go on the road, and so we go out for periods of time. Helen and I, we would go for, I think, maybe weeks, months. We would be gone on the road for months at a time, and Helen had all kinds of music pouring through her in the early years, there was another singer-songwriter who came to this peace house where I lived, and she received like 260 original songs from the angels. She was like an angel song chamber. And she'd been a Course in Miracles student for years, and then boom, when the channel opened up, she would be, I mean, the angels would even channel songs during my talks. One time I was giving a talk, I think, in St. Louis. She was there at the beginning, she disappeared with her guitar, and she comes out with like a three or four verse song channeled from the angels. And while she was gone, we got into all kinds of issues. The song dealt with all the issues. The angels streamed a song down for us for the gathering. And so she came back with her guitar. She said, "Well, I got a download from the angels. You want to hear it?" Yeah. Everybody had Wi-Fi. She wasn't even sitting with us. And the angels were streaming in the song relating to all the issues. So talk about how the Spirit just wants to flood us with joy and support. And it was fun. She did so many songs in her own style, and Helena took it and she brought in all her style, her instruments and music. The angels, of course, put no copyright on their songs, so that was nice. So we just, boom, that was a whole room. And then as the years went on, Helena had all kinds of songs that she received herself. Her and her husband Al received an amazing amount of beautiful songs, very mystical songs, that would turn kind of into mystical gatherings, you know, through the music. So that's what I mean by, you know, if the ego's in there going, yeah, yeah, where a relationship is a relationship, well, not actually. If you give your life over to Spirit, there's all kinds of possibilities, all kinds of configurations, all kinds of collaborations that can come in when you make the space for it, when you don't predefine how your life has to go. I feel I've had a very full, rich life. I've had to travel, I've had travel partners, I've had, I think the first time I went to Argentina, I believe that for like 2 weeks, I did a huge amount of gathering. I think I did pretty much a gathering every day, or multiple gatherings. And I had 14 translators that showed up, and I hadn't arranged any of them. They just, they would show up, and they were spectacular translators. And any time the translator would get kind of hung up on a metaphor, somebody from the audience would call it out. It was almost like a group translating experience, almost like Pentecost or something back in the days of the Bible where they all were, you know, speaking in the Spirit. It was like that feeling where they would show up and I would be like just amazed. I was in the middle of one tour down in Argentina where an event happened in the world events. I think the United States began dropping bombs on Baghdad during one of my tours in Argentina, and huge anti-American protests broke out all over the place. And the day after all these bombs were dropped, I went in to do another one of my gatherings, and the first question from this group of Argentinians was, "What is your view of your president?" You know, I've been talking for weeks on relationships, overcoming sickness, death, all the perennial questions, but it suddenly got very political because of one event in the world. And on the way to the gathering, they had an effigy of the American President George Bush burning, hanging from a pole in flames, and thousands of people marching in the streets and everything. Just went ahead. But that was the first question: what is your view of your president? Then I waited for the translation to come to me, you know, in English. I said, "Oh, I have no president." And so it went back in Spanish, and the woman was like, and so then it comes back to me, "What do you mean you have no president?" And I said, "Well, we're all children of God. We come from the same source. And this source transcends countries and cultures and religions." And I said, for me, definitely politics. I said, I definitely have no president. And then suddenly the whole energy in the room shifted when I began singing John Lennon's song, Imagine. And everybody in the room started, they all knew the lyrics of Imagine. So there we were, all singing together in that whole context of Imagine. There's no country, I wonder if you can. Nothing to kill or die for, a brother and a woman. It was like, ooh, it was soft. It went from kind of a weird, kind of a, an angry energy into a soft John Lennon melody, with all of us harmonizing together in English down in Buenos Aires, Argentina. To me, that only happens with the Holy Spirit. That only happens when you show up in love, with love, to extend love, and then the Holy Spirit changes everything. Another time I was down in Miramar, Argentina, down on the ocean south of Buenos Aires, and all I knew was there was a female bishop who was spreading A Course in Miracles down through Argentina, and she wanted to meet me, and she wanted to take me to a lot of small towns, and she had an idea. She said, I will get up on the stage for like 10 minutes, and I will introduce ideas of A Course in Miracles, and then I will introduce you, and you come up, and then you speak for maybe 40 minutes. And interact with the crowd. I said, oh, that's great, we'll do a little tour. So, and I said, yeah, female bishop, apparently she'd been blacklisted by the Catholic Church down there, and she found me, and I was willing to travel with her and go into the group. So we would go into little tiny halls, and one time we went into this little cafe, and so there's a tiny little stage, maybe like a third of this, just a tiny little stage, and you could get a cup of coffee, and you could buy things. It was a nice cafe. But we didn't know that we had walked into a hornet's nest. Apparently, the whole town was highly charged because one of the students, a female student at the local high school, had been raped and murdered. And the whole town was like on high alert, and the tensions, the emotions were running very strong, but we didn't know that. So she goes and she gets up on stage, and I thought, I'll get a cup of coffee and just wait till I'm introduced. Well, I just watched her. I don't know Spanish, but I do know what an angry mob looks like. The Spanish was flying very fast and was very heated, and their faces were turning red and their fists were shaking. And I think she was trying to go up there and talk about the teachings of A Course in Miracles. Nothing happens by accident. There is no death. She was probably giving all these sweet roses talk, but with really high metaphysics. And this was not the place. And so I was just sitting back there having my cup of coffee, but I just saw the mob got angrier and angrier. She was supposed to talk for 10 minutes, but they chased her off the stage like in 3 minutes after she threw both hands in the air and said, I cannot answer all your questions, as the mob was screaming, but there is one here who can. And then boom, she was off the stage. I had just begun sipping my cup of coffee. I was just sitting and just watching the whole thing. Well, looks like I'm not going to be drinking that cup of coffee. So I came up, and I got on the little stage, and I sat there, and I looked at them, and there was probably maybe like 20 sets of glaring eyes. They were all like glaring. Now it was a man. This female student had been raped and murdered. Now they brought this man up on the stage, and they're all looking at him. And one of them, they were all teachers at school. Those were female teachers at the school, and they were charged about this whole event. And they were staring at me, and so one of them, I just spoke very soft, gentle tones came out from the Holy Spirit, because it was like, we need a lot of softness here, a lot of gentleness, but very soft, very gentle. And then that went on for 4 or 5 minutes, and then finally I just was a lot of emotions that needed to come up and out. And one of the women was aware of A Course in Miracles, and I think she had picked the book up, and she popped open to the introduction. Mm. So she had read the introduction, including the thing that nothing real can be threatened, nothing unreal exists, here lies the peace of God. But she kind of still with clarity, and she said, I have heard, this was all translated to me from the Spanish, I have heard that this course is a required course. What does that even mean, required? You know, that was the first question. And I said, well, I said, really, the only thing that's required of us is forgiveness. I said, it doesn't matter what curriculum, whether you read this book or you never read this book. The only thing that's really required of us as human beings is forgiveness, because that's our gateway back to love. And it's all about love. It's all about returning to the love. And so she listened. It was very short and brief, but it was very soft and direct. And she went, Clara, Clara. It was okay. And then, as happens in all these things, they were able to start to ask their questions. They didn't start off with the rape and the murder. They just started off with what they were feeling in the moment, which is the way you have to deal with it. You have to address what's felt in the moment. There was a lot of anger and heaviness in the room, and so that was, and the spirit worked with them very gently, very gently. And then, as typical of my gatherings, as it went on, you could feel it just got lighter and lighter in the room. And then, I would say that in South America, people are very, normally very festive, lighthearted, and celebratory. That's like their norm. Is that, and quickly went from that heaviness and charge into a very lighthearted gathering, where there became lots of laughter and joy, and then after maybe about an hour or so, they all invited me out to a big ice cream party. So we all went for halalas, and we all just had so much joy. The joy and the laughter just replaced that. And that's been beautiful for me to watch when I go to some rural areas or whatever, and sometimes the group is kind of pensive or hesitant, or they're withholding. But they do, everybody's got all this love, and we quickly can find a way to get past that. And then the love just bursts open, and it's just this flowing, gushing love, and it's so natural. And that's what the spirit can do, and that's what really the spirit's designed to do in your mind, in our mind, in our lives, is do that. We practice that over and over, getting into the love, until it becomes really natural, like second nature. You don't have to, like when you first ride a bike, you have to go through some steps, but then when you know how to ride a bike, you know how to ride a bike. When you know how to just be in presence and extend the love, it just comes through very naturally. And then, I had two friends down there who had been in the same language school when they were 16. They lost touch with each other. They re-met at one of my gatherings, and I think they were about 56 years old. They ended up being on the sides of me translating, and as the spirit spoke through to this whole group, the woman on my left, Patricia, said, she was right behind me, she said, I got the best seat in the house. I get to sit here, watch you give a talk, and watch all the faces light up. It's like watching a Van Gogh painting with the yellows and the oranges and the splats of color coming in, because people get, she sees all the faces come to life. But it's just the spirit using the symbols, and it's fun to watch the faces light up. She was really enjoying translating for me. So we can go into this life with, even if we have heavy emotions, we can't push them aside. We have to be willing to let them move through. But even in terms of how our life's purpose will look or how our life will play out, we can open our minds up and just say, Jesus, just show me the way. You know, you use my life. Let my life be a painting for you. Let my life be a picture for you. You paint the colors. You, let's have your brush strokes come in here. Take the form of my life and use it in a way that blesses the whole of all humanity, and not just a sense of a personal life lived of a tiny little band between birth and death. Because what really does it mean, you know, this tiny little band between birth and death? If we watch nature, we see the birth and death of animals, we see humans and so forth. What kind of lasting meaning could ever come from all of these temporary things, including the body that we're surrounded by, that is in our awareness? We all know there's a greater destiny. We know there's a very deep calling. And we are to tap into that. We're to give over our future goals and ambitions and say, no, instead of me trying to scribble and make a pencil drawing, you give me a full color painting of what my full potential can be. You help me offer my contribution to the plan of awakening. And Jesus says that your part is essential. So it must be extremely important for us to do this. That we can't really wake up until we complete our part. We have to give our part fully before we can receive the benefit of that awakening. And we would have not one person left in chains. You know, we would give so fully and have such a fulfillment of our life's destiny that we have no regrets. Wouldn't it be great to reach a point in your life where you have absolutely no regrets whatsoever? No more coulda, woulda, shoulda. Oh, or no more if only, you know, those nagging thoughts. Those that rinse completely from all those if only thoughts. Even when I was growing up and I was a child, I would get all excited watching the sports channels or watching different things on television, and my grandfather, he'd be like in his 70s or so, and he would just laugh. The more I would get stirred up, the more emotional I would get watching the television. He would sit next to me and just laugh and laugh and laugh and laugh. And I finally started to get upset with him because he was having so much fun. I thought at my expense, and I would finally turn over to his, he had a German name. His name was Heinrich Hermann Hoffmeister. He was really, and I'd look at him, he would be twinkling, his eyes were twinkling, his big smile, his face laughing. And then I'd wait for the explanation for all this joy and happiness. Like, I don't, what's so happy, what's so... And he would hold up one finger to me like this, and he would give me instruction. He would say, because I would say, if only this had happened, if... I was always saying, if only, if only, if only, all the time. And he would hold up one finger, and he would go, if... largest word in the English language. Because if was hypothetical. I was going on and on and on always if something was different. And he was pointing out to me the teachings of A Course in Miracles. Mm-hmm. For one tiny word in the English language. If. If something was different. If the referee hadn't missed the call. If my team had scored. Of, you know, losing the ball. If. So I could see the Holy Spirit was working with me, you know, in retrospect, even as a child, with a grandfather like that, helping me get away from this hypothetical thinking, which is, it's like the disease of ego, it's the disease of being human, thinking you have control over things, and thinking you have to figure a way out, plan your life. And even worse, thinking you could have made better decisions and feeling guilt and regret and thinking you have a whole future open of these options, which is still hypothetical. And there's so much worry and concern about oh, I've only got so much time, and I've got to make the best of it, and I didn't make the best decisions before, so I better make better decisions in the future, or else, you know, it's like a pressure. It's a real pressure cooker, this ego. So a lot of the movies that I have, and the movie watchers Guide to Enlightenment, are all about going beyond hypothetical thinking. Some real good quantum movies, like the movie Next, is in my collection there, and it's really spectacular when you watch that with commentary, because it's a huge teaching on hypotheticals. And sometimes people may say, well, what do you mean everything in this world, you know, is hypothetical? But you know, that just means, like, if I'm talking about, like, oh, we're sitting here in a room right now, but soon we'll go to lunch. And the staff will have prepared, we know in our minds, hypothetically, our bodies will be over in the lunch, and we'll have drinks, and we'll have a nice lunch and everything. That's hypothetical, but this room is not hypothetical. This is actual. The ego would say, we're actually in a room, and actually listening to a talk, and so forth today. But actually, all of time and space is nothing more than a set of hypotheticals as if the separation occurred. This whole cosmos is hypothetical because it's an as if there's something more than love, or as if fear is real, as if the separation from God could occur. This everything, including us listening to a talk in this room, is a hypothetical situation. We become addicted to a realm of hypotheticals that, in truth, never happened. That love is all that there is, and all of this is a hypothetical, as if the separation from God occurred. Once you start to get a grasp of that, then you can begin to smell the roses. Then you begin to appreciate every moment, every person you meet. You start to appreciate everything because you realize it's all about the love and the moment and the connection. And you won't waste your time on anything else. I had some degrees even. I remember I was in university for 5 years in the College of Design, Art, Architecture, and Planning. Planning, that's what my degree was in. Five-year bachelor's degree in planning. And then I get to A Course in Miracles, and if you go into the course, if you go into lesson 135, for example, Jesus will tell you, a healed mind is relieved of the belief that it must plan. Relieved. So you can imagine, you know, you think you're working hard and 5 years of money and tuition and exams and projects and all this and this, and then Jesus gets a hold of your mind and says, no. You know, we're going in the other direction. You're not going to be a planner in this life. I'm going to come through you with miracles, and you're going to learn to be spontaneous, to be a spontaneous being, listening to my instructions in the moment. Basically, after 10 years of university, a couple degrees, basically I gave it all back to Jesus, and I said, there you go, take the whole thing, everything, education, my mind, my heart, my soul, my body, every possession, everything I've got, you take it all. That was a very good moment. Jesus was like, ah, now we begin. I needed that David to do my work.
What about the plan of God, the Course is speaking of?
Yeah, but it's interesting that the plan of God, whenever we hear the word plan, we do think of time. And I did have lunch with Judy Scutts recently, and she had received this writing from Jesus way back, I mean, decades ago, and she pulled it out. She said, here, I want you to take this with you, and it seemed to still be as if the separation has occurred, because it was saying that telling Judy and them, they weren't quite ready to step into their function at the time when the Course first came. And they said, also it was impossible to explain the plan to them because people were to meet who had not met yet. And there are all these aspects of this seeming plan that couldn't even be explained because the people hadn't even met that were going to meet. So as I looked at my 30 years with the Course, I see amazing numbers of encounters and collaborations and configurations that have played out of people I didn't know. If I hadn't had that moment with Jesus where I gave it all over, I can't even imagine that I would have even met these people or they would have met me. And it all played out. But it's still comforting for me to think that ultimately even the idea of a plan is still in the realm of imagination. That really what Jesus is coaxing us to do is come off of this linear perspective, personal perspective, and come into seeing that it's simultaneous. He says right in the Course that the very instant it seemed to happen, it was answered in that very instant. So it must be, if it seemed to occur in the unholy instant, then the holy instant answered that so perfectly that everything we think is going to take such a long time, all these meetings and all these things, it is really just an instant. Almost like that thing of how many angels can you fit on the head of a pin? How many years and millennium can we squeeze onto the head of a pin? Because the head of a pin is a point. And really, I feel more now that I'm just in a flow now where I'm just seeing holistically that everything that I perceive is all the mind. It's all in mind, and therefore I don't put a lot of into teaching the plan in a linear way. I can see where that was important for Helen and Bill. They were research psychologists, but after 30 years of the Course, I just feel it's all together. I feel we are all really together. And I see that everything that's occurring is the plan, is perfect. I see that this presence of love is behind absolutely everything. And that's why I've got a big smile on my face, because it doesn't matter where I am or what I'm watching. And recently I'm getting ready to go to China and Japan. So I'll start doing teachings in Japan. And it's been recently anniversaries of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And people, I'm sure I'll get some questions about that, and I have been getting questions. Like when people think of Europe, and they think of Nazi Germany, and they think of the World Wars, or they think of the end of the Second World War with the hydrogen bombs getting dropped over Nagasaki and Hiroshima. They go, how does that fit into the plan? How was World War I and World War II part of God's plan? Could be a very sincere question. I've actually come to the point, like I get little glimmers, was that even with Nazi Germany, it's interesting, Einstein was from over here, Austria, Germany area, and then going over to the United States, and E equals MC squared, and splitting the atom, and developing nuclear weapons, and everything that led up to those hydrogen bombs being exploded over Nagasaki and Hiroshima. It was interesting to me, I wasn't fully aware that actually Hitler and the Nazis were developing nuclear weapons. Mm-hmm. So it was interesting to me too that Einstein was quite a pacifist. And that Einstein, of all the men on Earth, I think Einstein was just amazing in terms of his intellect and his knowledge. But he admired Gandhi, another pacifist. In fact, Gandhi and Einstein lived at the same time, and I would say Gandhi was more of a pure pacifist. He was a pacifist that wouldn't budge on his pacifism. In fact, we know from his autobiography and the movie how extreme his pacifism was. Einstein admired that, but then when Hitler came along, he was like, I don't know if I can go with you there, Gandhi, all the way. Like, I don't think pacifism is going to stop Adolf Hitler. So he actually believed that there was some force that could be necessary. Gandhi didn't believe that, but Einstein did. And then, of course, Einstein didn't invent the nuclear weapons, but his E equals MC squared, a lot of his discoveries were used in that. And it's interesting that he believed there would have to be a force to stop Hitler. So I kind of see behind Einstein, behind Gandhi and everything, there's JC Central. Thank God Jesus is in charge at this point. Thank God there's someone who's completed his part perfectly, who's gone all the way outside, beyond, transcended time and space, and now is capable of even arranging time and space, it says in the Course. If you'll do miracles for me, I will arrange time and space for you. I'm glad Jesus is arranging time and space. Even with world wars and everything, we are in good hands, so to speak. And this plan cannot fail. It's completely been accomplished. And so, for us, it's just for us to take our part in the plan. I was over in Colorado recently, and Gary Renard was going to do a talk one night, and I was going to do the talk the next day. And Gary focused his whole talk on how Jesus was not a leader. He was a follower. He did his whole talk on his life, where he had to tune in and listen to the Holy Spirit and learn to follow the Holy Spirit in every instant in order to complete his part. And I enjoyed the whole talk, and then the next day I got up and I said, and now, having accomplished his part perfectly, Jesus is now the leader of the plan of atonement. He's in charge, of course, says in charge. So what does that mean? I like that. You don't miss a thing I do. You see every move I make. You have got the best view of everything. And literally, Jesus is capable of inspiring miracles. We have to be willing. But he's the one who's performing all these miracles. I've had so many miracles over the last 30 years. I can't even imagine all the miracles I've had. Symptom removal, raising the dead. I've had all kinds of spectacular miracles. Like Pierre was saying, very spectacular miracles for 30 years. And Jesus has been behind every one of them. Every one of them. He's the one who performs the miracles because he's in a position to perform the miracles. Human beings don't perform miracles. They're just vessels, vehicles. When we get out of the way, JC Central kicks it into gear. And when we're in the way, he's still there ready. He's ready to go, but we have to be ready and willing. Miracles cannot be performed in doubt and fear and hesitation. It's ready to go. It's ready to pour through you, but as long as you have doubt and fear and hesitation, it's like you're saying, no, I don't deserve it. I'm not willing to behold it. And also he talks about us being messengers. You know, he mentions in the workbook that we're messengers, but he says, interestingly enough, that the messenger must first receive the message for himself before he gives it away. It's always for our own mind first. We don't have to go teach anybody or tell anybody anything. We just have to be willing to be linked in, and then when we are, oh my, it's absolutely amazing what happens. And it all happens involuntarily, too. I realized that. I think when Marianne was talking about I want to relax, I've beheld a lot, but I really want to relax into it. To me, that's the relaxed part comes when you start to really feel the involuntary nature of miracles, that they don't really require any effort on our part at all. It's just when we just are so relaxed that we start to behold them. And then we start to transfer that in our life. We start to realize that everything is involuntary. That we've just been fooled into thinking we have to consciously be in control and We have to direct things and make things happen. The sound effects. As soon as I say make things happen. And that's the time. It's lunchtime. Right in the middle of joy and miracles. It's actually lunchtime. Okay. Yes. Okay. Is there any feelings for this afternoon, Francis?
Expression sessions tomorrow morning and the day after with the same group. So, can I have a feeling like